So the International Financial Services Center, the GIFT City, series of measures have already been taken in the past by this government. With a view to incentivizing the IFSC, I propose to provide several direct tax incentives to an IFSC, including 100% profit link deduction under Section 80LA in any 10-year block within a 15-year period, exemption from dividend distribution tax from current and accumulated income to companies and mutual funds, exemption on capital gain to Category 3 AIF, and interest payment on loan taken from non-residents. So, securities transaction tax. I propose to give relief in levy of securities transaction tax by restricting it only to the difference between the settlement and the strike price in case of exercise of option. Simplification and ease of living. India's ease of doing business ranking under the category of paying taxes showed a significant jump from 172 in 2017 to 121 in the year 2019. From 172, we have come to 121, a drastic improvement. I now propose to implement a series of measures that will leverage technology to make compliance easier for the taxpayer. Interchangeability of PAN and Aadhaar. Mr. Speaker, sir, more than 120 crore Indians now have Aadhaar card. Therefore, for ease and convenience of taxpayers, I propose to make PAN and Aadhaar interchangeable and allow those who do not have PAN card to file income tax returns by simply quoting their Aadhaar number and also use it wherever they are required to quote the PAN. So everywhere where you are required to quote the PAN, instead you can just do Aadhaar, and even if you don't have a PAN, there is no problem. So pre-filling of income tax returns. Pre-filled tax returns will be made available to taxpayers, which will contain details of salary income, capital gains from securities, bank interest and dividends, etc., and tax deductions also. Information regarding these incomes will be collected from the concerned sources such as banks, stock exchanges, mutual funds, EPFO, state registration departments and so on. This will not only significantly reduce the time taken to file tax return, but will also encourage accuracy of reporting of income tax. So faceless e-assessment. This is a very important thing about which there's been a lot of discussion. Assessees should not face any kind of harassment. The existing system of scrutiny assessments in the income tax department involves a high level of personal interaction between the taxpayer and the department, which leads to certain undesirable practices and on the part of the tax officials. To eliminate such instances and to give shape to the vision of Honorable Prime Minister, a scheme of faceless assessment in electronic mode involving no human interface is being launched this year in a phased manner. To start with, such e-assessments shall be carried out in cases requiring verification of certain specified transactions or discrepancies. Cases selected for scrutiny shall be allocated to assessment units in a random manner, and notices shall be issued electronically only by a central cell without disclosing the name, designation or location of the assessing officer. The central cell shall be the single point of contact between the taxpayer and the department. This new scheme of assessment will represent a paradigm shift in the functioning of the income tax department. So on digital payments, Our government has taken a number of initiatives in the recent past for the promotion of digital payments and less cash economy. To promote digital payments further, I propose to take a slew of measures to discourage the practice of making business payments in cash. To discourage the practice of making business payments in cash, I propose to levy TDS, tax deduction at source, of 2% on cash withdrawal exceeding 1 crore in a year from a bank account. I'll repeat this. To discourage the practice of making business payments in cash, I propose to levy TDS of 2% on cash withdrawal exceeding 1 crore in a year from a bank account. Further, there are low-cost digital modes of payment such as Beam UPI, UPI QR code, Aadhaar Pay, certain debit cards, NEFT, RTGS, etc., which can be used to promote less cash economy. I therefore propose that the business establishments with annual turnover of more than 50 crores shall offer such low-cost digital modes of payment to their customers, and no charges or merchant discount rate shall be imposed on customers as well as the merchants. No charges or merchant discount rates shall be imposed on customers as well as the merchants. RBI and banks will absorb these costs from the savings that will accrue to them on account of handling less cash as people move to these digital modes of payment. Necessary amendments are being made in the Income Tax Act and the Payments and Settlements System Act of 2007 to give effect to these provisions. So now about the revenue mobilization. I'm sure it's equally concerning for all of us. Mr. Speaker, sir, as I have started earlier, we have taken several measures in the past to alleviate the tax burden on small and medium income earners, as those having annual income up to 5 lakhs are not required to pay any income tax. We are thankful to the taxpayers who play a major role in nation building by paying their taxes. However, in view of the rising income levels, those in the highest income brackets need to contribute more to the nation's development. I therefore propose to enhance the surcharge on individuals having taxable income from 2 crore to 5 crores and 5 crore and above, so that effective tax rates for these two categories will increase by around 3% and 7% respectively. So the other measures, I also propose to simplify the tax law to reduce genuine hardships being caused to taxpayers, which include enhancing threshold of tax for launching prosecution for non-filing of returns and exempting appropriate class of persons from the anti-abuse provision of Section 50 CA and Section 56 of the Income Tax Act. So the indirect taxes. Now coming to indirect taxes, sir. We are aware that the landscape has changed significantly with the implementation of the GST. In every sense, this has been a monumental reform. Center and states coming together and agreeing to pool in their sovereign power of taxation for common good of the country was unprecedented. 17 taxes and 13 cesses became one tax. Multitude of rates instantly became 4. Almost all commodities saw rate reduction. Tens of returns were replaced by just one. Taxpayers' interface with tax departments got reduced. Border checks got reduced and eliminated in many cases. Goods started moving freely across states, which saved time and energy. A truck started doing two trips in the same time in which it was doing one. Thus, dream of one nation, one tax, one market was realized. The GST Council deserves all the credit for this. Sir, in the initial phase, GST witnessed certain teething problems. This was natural considering the scale of the reform. However, the Council, the Centre and the States proactively worked to resolve these issues. GST rates have also been reduced significantly, where relief of about 92,000 crores per year has been given. We should not lose sight of this fact when judging the performance of the GST. The details are given in the annexure. We are further simplifying the GST processes. A simplified single monthly return is being rolled out. Taxpayer having annual turnover of less than 5 crore shall file only quarterly returns. Free accounting software for return preparation has been made available to small businesses. A fully automated GST refund module shall be implemented. Multiple tax ledgers for a taxpayer shall be replaced by just one. It's also proposed to move an electronic invoice system wherein invoice details will be captured in a central system at the time of issuance. This will eventually be used to pre-fill a taxpayer's return. There will be no need for a separate e-way bill. Its rollout would begin from January 2020. Electronic invoice system will significantly reduce the compliance burden. Sir, on the customs side, my proposals are driven with the objective of securing our borders, achieving higher domestic value addition through Make in India, reducing import dependence, protection to MSME, and promoting clean energy, curbing non-essential imports and correcting inversions. Defence has an immediate requirement of modernization and upgradation. This is a national priority. For this purpose, import of defence equipment that are not being manufactured in India are being exempted from the basic customs duty. Make in India is a cherished goal in order to provide domestic industry a level playing field. Basic customs duty is being increased on items such as cashew kernels, PVC, vinyl flooring, tiles, metal fittings, mountings for furniture, auto parts, certain kinds of synthetic rubber, marble slabs, optical fiber cable, CCTV camera, IP camera, digital and network video recorders, and so on. Also, exemptions from customs duty on certain electronic items which are now being manufactured in India are being withdrawn. Further, end-use based exemptions on palm stearin, fatty oils, and eggs being withdrawn. To encourage domestic publishing and printing industry, 5% customs duty is being imposed on imported books. To further promote domestic manufacturing, customs duty reductions are being proposed on certain raw materials and capital goods. These include certain inputs of CRGO sheets, amorphous alloy ribbon, ethylene dichloride, propylene oxide, cobalt mat, naphtha, wool fibers, inputs for manufacture of artificial kidney and disposable sterilized dialyzer, and fuels for nuclear power plants. To further incentivize e-mobility, customs duty is being exempted on certain parts of electric vehicles. Customs duty is also being exempted on capital goods required for manufacture of specified electronic goods. So the export duty is being rationalized on raw and finished leather to provide relief to this sector. Crude prices have softened from their highs. This gives me room to review excise duty and cess on petrol and diesel. I propose to increase special additional excise duty and road and infrastructure cess, each one by 1 rupee a litre on petrol and diesel. It is also proposed to increase custom duty on gold and other precious metals from 10% to 12.5%. It is also proposed to increase custom duty on gold and other precious metals from 10 to 12.5%. Tobacco products and crude attract national calamity and contingent duty. In certain cases, this levy has been contested on the ground that there is no basic excise duty on these items. To address this issue, a nominal basic excise duty is being imposed. Sir, I am also proposing few amendments to the Customs Act. Recent trends reveal that certain bogus entities are resorting to unfair practices to avail undue concessions and export incentives. While we have intensified our efforts against such nefarious activities, provisions are being incorporated in the Act for enhanced penalty and prosecution for such offences. Further misuse of duty-free scrips and drawback facility involving more than 50 lakh of rupees will be a cognizable and non-bailable offence. GST has completed 2 years. An area that concerns me is that we have huge pending litigations from pre-GST regime. More than 3.75 lakh crores of rupees is being blocked in litigations and service tax and excise. There is a need to unload this baggage and allow businesses to move on. I therefore propose a legacy dispute resolution scheme, that will allow quick closure of these litigations. I would urge the trade and business to avail this opportunity and be free from legacy litigations. The details of my tax proposals are given in the annexure. Sir Speaker, I thank you for this opportunity, and with these words, I commend the budget to this august house. Thank you.
To Srimati Nirmala Sitaram, Maniya Vitt Mantri ji.
I just would like to mention, although I have commended the budget, I just would like to mention, I have not mentioned specific allocations for the scheme and programs. I have not mentioned specific allocations for schemes and programs. All these details are available in the budget documents as much as my speech's annexure. I also thank and take this opportunity for the response that we've received for the crowdsourcing of ideas for the budget. Immense suggestions from common citizens reached us. We have benefited from the crowdsourcing. The one last mention, which is more for the curiosity's sake, the fiscal deficit this year is 3.3%, brought down from 3.4%. Thank you. Sir, with your permission, I rise to lay on the table the statements regarding medium-term fiscal policy, come fiscal policy statement, and the macroeconomic framework statement. Under Section 3, Subsection 1 of the Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management FRBM Act 2003.
Item number 3.
Sir, with your permission again, I rise to move for leave to introduce the Finance Number 2 Bill 2019.
Prashna Yeki वित्त विधेयक को पुनर्स्थापित करने की अनुमति प्रदान की जाए। जो सदस्य इसके पक्ष में हां कहें, जो सदस्य इसके विरोध में ना कहें, मेरे विचार में निर्णय हां वालों के पक्ष में आए, हां वालों के पक्ष में आए, अनुमति प्रदान की जाती है। माननीय मंत्री जी, अब विधेयक को पुनर्स्थापित करें।
सर, आई नाउ इंट्रोड्यूस द बिल।
माननीय सदस्यों, मैं इस सभा की ओर से देश की पहली पूर्णकालिक महिला वित्त मंत्री जी को बजट पेश करने के लिए बहुत बहुत बधाई देता हूं, और मैं सभी माननीय सदस्यों को भी 2 घंटे 15 मिनट तक आपने जिस शांतिपूर्ण ढंग से सरकार के पहले बजट को सुना, उसके लिए भी आपको बहुत बहुत बधाई देता हूं। सभा की कार्रवाई सोमवार दिनांक 8 जुलाई 2019 को सुबह 11 बजे तक के लिए स्थगित की जाती है।